All right, so our goal is to find constants A and B that make this function y equals e to the at times cosine of bt solve this second order differential equation. The background behind this is an example of a model of a mass on a spring harmonic oscillator with some damping, with some friction. And really, we're just guessing the answer here that we might have a function like this. What's the motivation for this kind of guess? When you have a mass and a spring going back and forth, that's an oscillation. That's like a cosine or a sine with some period. And if it's got some friction, maybe there's an exponential decay involved. Maybe e to the at will be a factor of the solution, where a is some negative constant, actually. That's what we're really after, is we hope at least is some negative constant that will help a function like this solve this differential equation. No guarantees that it will. This is just some guesswork. That's something that is necessary to do sometimes with differential equations. So you go ahead and you do your legwork, take the derivative, take the second derivative. It's kind of a mess. There's the first derivative. Use the product rule, right? A e to the at is the derivative of e to the at. That's the derivative of the first function times the second function, cosine of bt, plus the second function, e to the at, right there, times the derivative of cosine of bt. That'll be negative b sine bt. So we get the negative sign there. Use the product rule again, along with the chain rule, and the second derivative is a real big mess. These two terms can be combined to give you negative 2ab e to the at sine bt. And then these two terms can be combined because they both involve an e to the at and a cosine of bt. You can factor that out, and the coefficient is a squared minus b squared. Now take these three expressions and plug them into the left-hand side of the differential equation. I haven't done that yet. Let me see if I can do it as efficiently as possible. Focus first on the terms involving cosine of bt. That's this term here from the second derivative, plus 4 times that term from the fact that we have a 4y prime there, plus 13 times this one. Let's put it down here. So the things involving cosine, I can also factor out an e to the at, will be a squared minus b squared. Then again, plus 4a from this term right there, and the fact that there's a 4 right there, plus 13 by itself from the fact that there's a 13y there times this. That's what gets multiplied by cosine of bt and also e to the at. Cosine of bt and e to the at. What about the sine terms? There's this one from the second derivative. There's 4 times this one from the term right there. And there's no sine up there. So the 13y doesn't affect any sine terms. So the sine terms end up being minus, I'll put the minus sign out in front, 2ab from this one, and then 4b from this one, it looks like. E to the at sine bt. Right, double check that. Does that look good? The right-hand side of the differential equation is 0. We'd call it a homogeneous equation, analogous to with linear algebra having right-hand sides that are all 0. This is a homogeneous second-order differential equation. We want to set this equal to 0. Sometimes mathematicians use three lines for set equal to. We want it to always be 0, no matter what t is. So the coefficients have to be 0. It's often helpful to factor if you can. You can factor out a b there. You can also factor out a 2. 2b times in parentheses a plus 2. One thing that makes that coefficient a zero is when b is 0. Though that's not going to correspond to an oscillation, because then you get cosine of 0, which is always 1. You just get an e to the at. And it turns out if you plug in b equals 0 there, you'll solve for a with the quadratic formula and get complex number solutions. Now, complex numbers do turn out to be useful in this class, just not right now. We are after real values for A and B. So instead, we choose the other possible solution related to this thing being zero. Set this equal to zero. I'll just use two lines that time. A equals negative two is going to be the one of interest for us. Yes, B equals zero does make that zero, but it's not of interest for us. So set A equal to negative two and then plug that in there for A and solve for B. And we end up getting a real solution for B, in fact, two real solutions. When you set this equal to zero and you plug in A equals negative two, you'll get four minus B squared, right? Negative two squared is four. Plus four times A is minus eight, four times negative two, plus 13 equals zero. Four minus eight plus 13 is nine. Bring the B squared over to the other side, nine equals B squared. So B is plus or minus three. Which one should it be? It actually doesn't matter. Plus or minus three here for B would give you the exact same function because cosine is an even function. Cosine of negative X equals cosine of X no matter what X is. So whether you plug in B equals three or negative three, it's really the same function. So that does it. One answer for A and B is A equals negative two, B equals three. So e to the negative 2t times cosine of 3t will be one example of a solution of that differential equation. It's actually not the only solution. There's, as you might expect, based on what we've seen so far, there's actually infinitely many solutions to this differential equation. This is just one of them. What does its graph look like? You could try with your calculator. It's an oscillation that decays in amplitude. What's the period of the oscillation from the high point here to the high point there? What's the horizontal period? Call it capital T for time period. Same as a wavelength is if the independent variable represents a distance. It's 2 pi over 3, right? You take the 2 pi over whatever that coefficient is. 2 pi over 3 is this distance from here to here. And, you know, that would be around 2 seconds or so if time is in seconds. That would be the period of the oscillation. It's technically not actually a periodic function because the oscillation is getting smaller in amplitude. But if we're focused on the peak-to-peak distance horizontally in time, you could call it a period. Okay?
In reality, this e to the at cosine of bt is what all oscillations equations are, or most oscillation equations
are? These are the kinds of things you get for solutions of this differential equation, if that's what you're asking. You also get things involving sine of BT as well, and what are called linear combinations of those. In fact, let's go ahead and have Mathematica solve this differential equation for its general solution. And here, by the way, I verified the derivatives here. But we could also do D solve value with the differential equation to try to find its general solution. And it is a what you would call a linear combination of e to the negative 2t times cosine of 3t and e to the negative 2t times sine of 3t. Here's a connection to linear algebra. These two functions, e to the negative 2t times cosine of 3t and e to the negative 2t times sine of 3t, are going to form what we call a basis for the solution space. And that's analogous in linear algebra to what are called basis vectors. Like I hat and J hat are sometimes called basis vectors for the plane R2. If you had a third dimension, I hat, J hat, and K hat are called basis vectors for three-dimensional space R3. And what that means is essentially any linear combination, well, any vector in three-dimensional space is a linear combination of I hat, J hat, and K hat, a unique linear combination. Likewise, any solution of this differential equation will be some unique linear combination of e to the negative 2t times cos 3t and e to the negative 2t times sine 3t. We're starting to see analogies between differential equations and linear algebra here.